Heather, you say that we're asking the wrong questions. What are the right questions to ask?
So one of the most interesting things for those of us who work in cinema studies and are interested in digital humanities approaches to our work is how relatively behind we are in cinema studies. We have a vast sort of database of moving images. And if you're only even just talking about feature films, we're looking at 115 years worth of data. And yet nobody has really come up with an effective way to analyze all that data. And that's just talking about feature films.
My speech today will be basically for me an opportunity for expressing my frustration in doing research in the digital era. Thanks to international agencies like the European Audiovisual Observatory or national agencies, we have data about the theatrical performances of films. But no data are available about film exploitation in the home video market and in the pay and free-to-air television market. We know that a film collects between 15 and 20% of its total incomes through the theatrical release. It means that we have no idea about the most lucrative markets in which films are released. So we have a problem concerning data collection for the markets that we usually call secondary markets and for the emerging digital market.
Big is beautiful, right, often. Oh, that must be so cool, you've got loads of data. It must be more important than me with my little data. And I think there's something quite interesting about what that starts to do to conversations, actually. Well, you know, we're doing qualitative work, but we've got 600 data bits of video, and, you know, et cetera, but you've only got 10. So somehow what we're doing is richer. And I think there's also something really interesting and philosophically, we've had to think a lot about that.
How can we place all this data into a larger social, historical, and cultural context that doesn't just become an analysis of statistics, but can offer broader sort of intellectual insights?
Most of what you've been describing here are studies of contemporary or very recent phenomena. So what about the diachronic aspect? And obviously that raises all sorts of questions about the availability and quality of data going back. But, you know, I'm interested in this stuff because I want to study the representation of history or the past in Italian cinema going back to 1905. And that's to get at the kind of questions that Angelos was gesturing at, I think. So what do we do about that then?
Let me tell you what quantitative data did for our project. We had a very specific question, right? What European films travel well? And we were able to answer that. We could tell you which films travel. And not only that, we could tell you why they traveled, because we could find out different variables on the films. In certain languages, they travel better. If they have certain directors, they travel better. If they have certain production conditions, their co-productions, for example, they travel better. And that's what quantitative data allows you to do. You know, it allows you to answer these questions in a very robust kind of way. But it doesn't, as you say, allow you to answer that question of what these films mean to people.
Machines are much better at reading activity, for example, shot length, things like that, than they are at reading or looking for meaningful images. Some of you may remember that back in the good old days, or the early days of Netflix, Netflix used a star system to sort of show compatibility between what you like and what they have. So a film might earn a rating of 3.5 stars because based on what you had watched previously, you had rated other films along those lines. But in, I think around 2012, I'm not sure of the date, they decided that Netflix could be so much better if they asked human beings to watch films and then tag those films with all sorts of interesting data. Because the computer could only get them so far. This is a model that is much more relatable to me as a humanities scholar working in film. And the project that I've developed is a far cry from Netflix's model, which is why I'm poor. but it's an interesting start.
So then we've got the content stuff, and this is what I want to talk to you a little bit about. Now, this is where we got involved in the construction of an extremely elaborate code book to code the content of 600 plus videos. That is a qualitatively informed coding process. It's been an extraordinarily challenging thing to find people who approach massive data sets with a qualitative sensibility.
What I've realized through my work is that the way that we think about quantitative and qualitative methods is really problematic. So going back to this idea by Boskowski and Siles, this idea of methodological cosmopolitanism, they define it as an empirical sensibility towards the use of multiple methods on the links between production and consumption and materiality and content in the life cycle of media technologies. The goal of cosmopolitanism is not simply to add methods with different strengths within a single study, but to combine them in an empirical apparatus that can capture the interpenetration of the relevant dimensions of media technologies within a given project. So that actually, for me, captures the problems when we think about mixed methods or using quantitative and qualitative methods. And I see it in my students often, because they often say, I'm going to use this method and then I'm going to add this method in order to triangulate. And what they're doing is just adding the methods and not really thinking about what they're trying to ask.
One of the ways that my project developed was through my participation in a digital humanities workshop that my institution hosted, and some advice that I received from a senior colleague who's an art historian who had done some seminal work using digital humanities tools in her own field. She gave me the advice. She said, if you want to go into digital humanities, especially as a junior scholar, the very best place to start is with pedagogy.
Teaching these kinds of methods that we haven't really worked out yet lends itself well to pedagogical innovation in the sense that we can't teach methods in the way we used to teach methods.
Most of my colleagues come from a tradition of textual analysis. And I think if we're going to make the most of this huge amount of data which is available online, and if we want to really understand how the film industry is working, how audiences engage with films, then we have to make the most use of this data.
Resisting data is literally a badge of honour for a lot of people. Now, and I don't know what we do about that, but it's a structurally embedded and part of our disciplinary conversation. So I think that's really quite important to contextualize, and the students pick up on that.
I also teach film economics in Italy, in Milan. And well, yes, in Italy, I'm the only one scholar in film economics. And I am involved in a master program in Litcha. So I'm at the border of this master program. But it's very easy for my students to find a job in film institutions, national, local, or sovereign national institutions, film festival, film companies, because they are familiar with numbers.